إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، all praise due to Allah, we praise Him abundantly. We bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. He is alone, having no partners. And we bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his slave and his messenger. We ask Allah to exalt his mention, grant him peace, send his blessings and his salutations upon him, upon his companions, his wives, and all those who follow them on their path of righteousness until the day of recompense. Before we dig deep into the topic, I would like to express my gratitude and appreciation that I have been invited once again. I know seeing someone too many times can become somewhat boring, and so I will make I'll try my best not to bore you to death in this particular lecture. But I'm really happy that Allah Azza wa Jal has facilitated this once again, and we hope that it would be a source of benefit for all of us in this worldly life and in the life to come. I see a lot of familiar faces and some new faces which we have not seen before. Basically, the purpose behind these lectures is not really some academic adventure of some sort. You don't get any credit for this, for your grades. It's not going to help you in your career, I believe, from a professional point of view. However, these lectures are held and conducted for a number of objectives, the most important of which is our spiritual growth. And that is applicable to every human being, irrespective of his background, religion, race, so forth. So we try to make these topics relevant to our lives, each in his own way, whether male or female, whether Muslim or non-Muslim. They are not meant to be a source of controversy. They are not meant to be a source of troublemaking. We don't use them as a platform for spreading hatred and disunity. It's the opposite. Now, some people may have some weird intentions. I speak on behalf of the organizers, having known them for a few years. This is never the intention. We're always trying to make things swift for everybody, so that we can wind up in paradise one day. Because everything else is going to just perish. And the only thing which will matter is the benefit which we attain, how much closer to Allah we get via these lectures. So let's try to reconsider our intents or our intentions and see where the benefit is, so we take it, and the elements which are irrelevant or controversial, we just leave them aside, ignore them. We don't want to make them a reason for people to have hatred towards each other. We call for love, and we invite people for love. And Islam is a religion that teaches love. But we all know that in life, it cannot all be about love, right? Ask the male and female couples, and you realize that along with love, there's conflict, there's dissatisfaction, there's frustration. Sometimes there's divorce after marriage, because that's just the way life is meant to be. In order to discuss the topic, there must be at least 100 entrances which I can use to discuss the eternal challenge. And it's a very challenging situation. But I was thinking, what are we discussing? Depending on the topic or the subject we're discussing, either you have a lot of options or you may have zero options. You have to invent some sort of options. But if we're speaking about a book that is not written by human beings, then we already have something that is extremely unique. And no other topic, no other book can ever be addressed in this way. If any other human being wanted to give a lecture about any other book, He will not be able to use what we have the privilege to use when we speak about the Quran. Because we say, we claim, we submit before you that the Quran is the book of Allah. It's the book of the Creator. It was not written by human beings. Let's say it was not authored by human beings. Obviously, we had to write it down at some point for us to print it. But the actual words are not the words of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, nor are they the words of Gabriel, the angel who delivered that message from God to the Prophet Muhammad. They are not the words of the companions of the Prophet Muhammad, and surely they are not the words of Muslims today. And until now, this remains to be a challenge between Muslims and the rest of the world. And the rest of the world is saying to us, you guys are somewhat arrogant to claim that you have a book that has been preserved by God, and all other religions with all other scriptures don't have this privilege. And you're right. It's a tough position to be in. But the truth is, you have to declare the truth. It is upon the one who doesn't believe to prove that this is an incorrect position, it's an invalid position, then we have a case. If that cannot be done, and the lecture will explain why that cannot be done, then the challenge remains eternal. It's an eternal challenge. Currently, how old is the challenge? Now, how old is the challenge? Let's see, let's get some interaction before you guys fall asleep. I drink the coffee, you wake up. Who spoke? I'm sorry, can you raise your hand?
1,400,000.
Oh, 1,400,000, whoa. Wait, what was your grade in math, Akhi? I'm just kidding. It's okay.
Yeah.
I'm always going to find something to make a joke about, so don't think it's personal. I don't know you. I didn't do a history check on you before I came here. This is just a random joke. So, 1400 years? That's sometimes complicated because people are not used to 1400 years. So can we say 1,400 years? Is that a long time or a short time? 1,000 years, wow. 1,000 years ago, what was going on? People were using smartphones? Huh? I wonder how it was when everybody, you know, was traveling somewhere and, you know, not everyone, now where anywhere you go, everybody's on his phone. The teacher, the students, the professor, husband, wife, kids. It's unbelievable. So 1,000 years ago, things were quite different. 1,400 years ago, they were much more different. And surely people were a lot more eloquent than we are today. People were more into language than we are today. Now we have, you know, icons and, you know, a different type of broken language, so we can save time when typing. TTYL. What does that mean? Does anyone know what TTYL stands for? Talk to you later. So someone told me TTYL, I told him NWJ. They're like, what the hell is NWJ? I said, no way, Jose. I said, you're crazy. I said, I know. Well, I mean, what the heck is TTYL? How am I supposed to run this, talk to you later? Anyway, so now we're very brief and efficient. That was not the case 1400 years ago. Specifically at the time of the Messenger of Allah. Specifically the tribe of the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad, peace be upon him. That environment, that era, from every aspect, was known for having people who only stood out amongst other civilizations when it came to their language arts. They were artistic in language. They were poetic in language. They were eloquent in language. No other skills was known among the Arabs. There wasn't anything special. Obviously, you know, riding horses and camels, that was by default. But that was also shared by other civilizations who also had different types of skills. But they stood out linguistically. And amazing, if a challenge was made then and it wasn't met, how is it possible that it will be met today? The further we get away from that time, the more difficult the challenge and the more impossible. So the highest probability for someone to meet that challenge, which I'm keeping the challenge a secret, just to kind of, you know, hopefully keep you on your toes. No, I'm not Alfred Hitchcock. You don't even know who that is, right? You guys are still young. Who's above 30 years old? I'm in the wrong place. Okay, I'll raise my hand. So what was I saying? Yeah. So I'm not telling you the challenge on purpose. It's not like I forgot. The highest probability was then. And now, it is impossible. What is the challenge? The challenge is the one thing. We have many things, but if we only use this one thing to prove the validity and the authority of the Quran, then that would be sufficient. If the Muslims had to present to the whole world one aspect which proves that this Quran is from Allah, it is not man-made, it is not a human author. If that was the only thing we use, we have many, by the way, but if we only use this one, then that would be sufficient as an evidence to prove that this book is authoritative and it has superiority over any other scripture anywhere in the world. And if so, then it becomes incumbent on every human being to look at the Quran in a more serious way, to give it a little more consideration, because that book is unique. And if someone were to, in this day and time, present anything to us where they claim some sort of unique element to it, we will immediately try to challenge that. If someone told you, did you read about the latest book, assuming that there's a new book by some author, or for those who listen to, you know, rap, right? Some sort of rapper who claimed to be a god, right? The rap god. Because, you know, he can freestyle or he can say the word so quickly with the rhyme and so on and so forth. If someone made some sort of challenge, even people that are not interested will go and listen. Let me see what this guy did. And maybe without anyone knowing, they will go back home and try to write something on their own. Or try to emulate, try to copy that person. Then they say, wow, I can't do that. Even though I have the lyrics of that rapper, I cannot deliver them in the same way he delivered them. For example. Why? This is human nature. When someone challenges you with something that they are unique in doing that you cannot do, you try to see if it relates to you. If you're able to copy, then you know your limits when you're unable to do it. So why is it then that the Quran would not be given a similar treatment? Why is that? That's because of an ancient reason. Before the challenge, here's what Allah said in the Quran about those who rejected the Quran at the time of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, while the revelation was being sent out. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَا تَسْمَعُوا لِهَذَا الْقُرْآنِ وَالْغَوْ فِيهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَغْلِبُونَ. And those who disbelieved in the revelation, they said, do not listen to this Quran. Don't listen to the Quran. Be careful of the Quran. They were afraid because they knew it had an immediate impact on the listener. So instead of having the person exposed to the Quran and then they might convert to Islam, they were trying to save them, supposedly by saying, don't even listen to it. Because if you listen to it, it will affect you. وَالْغَوْ. And then whenever the Quran is being recited, speak noisily. Make a lot of noise. Perhaps you will overcome them. Maybe we would be able to overcome them. Why? The Quran had such an influence, such an impact on the tribe and the village of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, that the only way out was don't even come in contact with the Quran. Why? It was speaking to the minds of the people. The Quran was speaking to the minds of the people because it's the language of the Creator. It is not some weak language that human beings created or human beings wrote. And so the impact was immediate.
And it, this was then, and now it is happening in the same way. It does not have to be in the same words. But human behavior signifies that we need to sideline Islam. How do we do it? Islam is equal to terrorism. Islam is equal to extremists. Islam is equal to violence. Islam is equal to people with flags and machine guns and the whole art. This is the media pumping this stuff on a daily basis. So much so that the Muslims, before the non-Muslims, believe it now. They believe that Islam must represent some sort of military identity, and that without a military identity, you're like a fake Muslim. You're not really standing up for your religion. You're letting the non-Muslims walk all over you, blah, blah, blah. This is the image now that the media has successfully, the propaganda associated with Islam. This is their means, modern means of saying, don't listen to the Quran. Islam will teach you violence. But here we have a crowd of Muslims. And we notice, as for what we see, that there's no violence associated. Unless you have something up the sleeve. In which case, this is the door, please leave. This is not in the DNA of every Muslim. Surely, some will take that route. And some will find it justifiable to take that route, depending on their country, the kind of oppression they're going through. We cannot speak on behalf of everybody. But we can say on behalf of our religion is not equal to violence. It is not equal to terrorism. Our religion is guidance for mankind. Inner peace. Guidance for your own good. Because no matter what happens around us in regards to this materialistic world, this will not determine the matters of paradise and hell. At the end of the journey, there's going to be paradise and hell. And you will enter one of the two. There's no third destination. No one can say, I'll go right in between. Or I'll turn around and come back to this world. Or I will become dust. I will just perish with the perishables on the day. No such option is available to any human being who is sound. Even if he's crazy. At the end of the day, each one of us who has been born into this world will wind up at some point either in paradise or in the hellfire. It's a very serious issue. And it has to do with our reaction to this book of God. To the message that is being communicated. What is the challenge then? The challenge is represented in some words. Ironically, it is a verse or verses from the Quran that pose the challenge about the Quran itself. Because it could be from the Prophet Muhammad, from his own tradition, his own words. But this is actually in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah. Wherein Allah said, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِهِ وَادْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. If you are in doubt, and this is a divine message to mankind, every human being, even if he doesn't speak Arabic, it has been translated for his convenience now. If you are in doubt, you have 0.001% doubt regarding that which we have revealed upon our servant, the Prophet Muhammad, received the Quran. If you're in doubt, then Allah gave you an option, an outlet, a solution. Then produce one chapter, the like. Make, author, write, do whatever you want to make one chapter the like thereof. And then, in case you feel that one person is insufficient to meet this challenge or task, وَادْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ, and call on to all of your witnesses or assistants other than Allah, if you are truthful. Now one may say, okay, one chapter of the Quran. I don't know what that means. if one tells you, if your teacher tells you, let's say your teacher gives you 10 books, okay, 10 books. One book, one of them has 400 pages, and another one has 2 pages, okay? And at the end of the year, he tells you, I want you to write a book like any of these 10 books for your final grade. Which book would you choose? The one with the 400 pages? The one with the 2 pages, right? Does he have the right to say, what is that? Because you will say to him, you gave us 10 books. One of them was 2 pages. You told me to write a book like any one of these 10 books. I chose this book. Logically, you would go for the easiest option. So if this is the challenge from the Quran, let's use the same methodology. You can choose a big surah, big chapter, that would be difficult. What is the easiest one? Thank you for the adhan. We used to have a rule back in the day. It says that if your phone goes off during the lecture, then it would be confiscated. But since I'm a guest here, I better shut up and forget about it before somebody gets mad over his phone. No, seriously, try to put your phone on silent. I know this adhan application is meant to go off even if you have it on silent. So trick the system and like shut off the notification. So what is the smallest surah? What would be the easiest challenge, ya Akif? Surah al-what? Kawthar? Who knows Surah al-Kawthar from among the Muslims here? Can you, those who know Surah al-Kawthar, please raise your hand. MashaAllah, look at all these scholars we have. All these mashayikh. How many non-Muslims do we have, by the way? Can you please raise your hands? It's okay, we're not going to beat you up. 1, 2, 3. Okay, good enough. Did you think that all of them will know one chapter? Is it possible that, you know, everybody knows this chapter? It's usually far-fetched, but it happens. How many words are in this chapter? Who can count? Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar, صح? Fasalli لِرَبِّكَ وَنْحَرْ إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرْ. 10 words. This chapter is only 10 words. 10 words. It's a line and a half. 3 verses. And here we have a challenge. That's pretty wild. A challenge to all of mankind from that time until the day of judgment. You have all this time, with all the manpower possible, you can collect, you can gather, you can accumulate. All of you come together and produce just 10 words equal to that of the Quran. If you do so, then there will be no Muslim sitting here in this hall today. Right or wrong? We can no longer be Muslims. Why? Because the challenge in our book has been met. That will take away from the authority of the Quran everything. It will take away everything from the Quran, because we're saying that Allah spoke these words and the Creator challenged the creation. The creation were able to meet the challenge, then the Creator lost authority. Because the Creator is superior. If the creation was superior to the Creator, then we don't have a Creator anymore. Right or wrong? So from a logical point of view, there would be no Islam. Wouldn't that be much easier for all those who hate Islam? Don't you think it would be much easier rather than going to the different countries and fighting and killing and bombing people? Why don't you just make one chapter and finish it already? And all the Muslims would have to choose another religion the next day, unless they're stubborn. But it's amazing that that never happened. And that's not the amazing part, that is amazing. It gets even more amazing when the answer for that challenge comes in the very next verse. For example, your manager at work, or in your case, most of you don't work, your student, your teacher gives you a task, project. He knows the project is difficult, rather impossible. But what would he usually do? He'll give you what? Time. Okay? I want you to build a car from the ground up. And you're still in the first year as a mechanical engineer or something like that. Just too much for you. It's impossible. You have not learned enough to be able to do this. So he gives you some time to prove your own failure. He never knows. Maybe you have some skills. Maybe you would rely on someone else. What would be wild is if your teacher gave you this task, and then before you even responded, he told you, oh, by the way, you will never be able to do it. Because that's now insulting. Why? He didn't give you a chance. He knows, but he didn't give you a chance. Usually, a chance is given until proven incapable. Not the other way around. So in the Quran, in the ayah in the Quran, the very next verse says what? فَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَلَنْ تَفْعَلُوا فَاتَّقُوا النَّارِ. If you are unable to do it, and you will never be able to do it. Ouch. That's tough. That was the next verse. Not a page later, not a year later, not a chapter later. The next verse. First, bring all your manpower, bring all your people, take as much time as you want, bring 10 words like the Quran. Then, right when you're starting to get excited about the project, you will never be able to do it. Sit down. And you're like, whoo. This is the eternal challenge. Now, how easy it would have been for someone to say, no, forget that. I will not be, treated like this. I will not submit to this type of authority. I will not accept that someone speaks down to me like this. I will meet the challenge. I will produce something like the Quran. It would have been easy if someone had done that. But as our brother mentioned, 1,400,000 years have passed, and no one has been able to do this. Why? Why did that happen? Because the Quran must have certain elements that distinguish it from other scriptures. And with all due respect, excuse me, to all followers of different religions, to the respect of the individual on a human level, no one can ever find in their scripture anything of this sort. Not even close. So then you are one of two people. Either someone who is sensitive, someone who is emotional, and that person will always what? Deny. Like when different reactions, when someone dies, and then who's come to the relative of the deceased? Some people take it, like a man, as they say, and they cope. And some people are in denial. Right or wrong, they go to them and, oh, you didn't die, talk to me, speak to me, and the person is dead. And it takes them a while to accept the idea that person has passed away and moved on. Now we may sympathize with the one in denial. We may sympathize with them. We feel bad that they are so hurt. But from a logical point of view, we say, this is deficient. You're not accepting facts. You're not accepting reality. You are in a state of denial. This is psychologically inaccurate. It's unstable. So we will sympathize emotionally. We will reject from a logical point of view, from an intellectual point of view. And this is the same thing that happens when we discuss religion. And this has been said many times over the years. When we discuss religions and the information comes to you that is somewhat challenging, it's intimidating, you are either mature, you're smart, say, okay, this is interesting. Let me cope with this. I'm a grown person. I have a mind of my own. There's no harm in being wrong in the past. Let me deal with this in a mature way. That's not the common reaction though. These people are actually select. They are the elite among human beings. These are the real smart people. The other types of people are the ones who say, oh no, but they will give you now hundreds of excuses as to why this information is not sufficient, not satisfactory, not logical, even though they have no real argument. But now emotionally they want to reject. Why? Intimidation. They cannot deal with it. They cannot cope with the truth. They go to denial. And those are the ones whom we fear for. Because this was the trait of all those who disbelieved in their respective messengers when messengers used to be sent by God to mankind. That was their trait. It was that type of internal pride that made them say to their prophets, even though the prophets were doing miracles before them, they would say, you're nothing but a magician, you're nothing but a liar, you're nothing but a poet. Excuse me. Miracles were done before them. It was not sufficient for them to believe. So the Quran presents this challenge. And if we were to go into this discussion, which could be lengthy, but not only lengthy, extremely interesting as to the linguistic, miraculous nature of the Quran. Because one may say, "What? I don't understand. You're saying 10 words? Like really no one was able to write 10 words which just sound like the Quran? Okay, what does the Quran sound like? Let me hear the Quran, show me the rhyme, and I can write something that sounds the same. Similarly in English, right? If someone, for example, told you this rapper, again, we're going to give the example of rapper since I don't know why. For example, some of them play with words, right? They write like each verse begins with the same letter alphabetically in alphabetical order. So A, all of the words in that verse will begin with A, then B, then C, and so forth. They do this sometimes just to play with words. Someone would say, look man, I'm not a rapper. But if you show me an example, I don't have a problem sitting down. Give me a pen and paper and I can do something similar. So if you say obnoxiously, abnormal, authentic, awfully, I don't know what, something, you know? They say, okay, I can write similar words where when I deliver, you cannot differentiate between the original one and mine. Why? I have time. I can go through the dictionary, which is what many rappers do nowadays. Huh? Very natural. They open a dictionary and go through all the words. Let me see this word. I think it will sound like, nobody knows what it means, neither do I, but it's fine. It just sounds nice in this. Perfect. Yeah, that's just how some of them do. They Google it now. All the words that rhyme with stylish. And they get Irish, you know, I don't know what else. They put them all in one verse. I'm an Irish stylish. Oh, mashallah, mash. So we got funny people, man. If you heard some of these stuff, it's like, what is this guy doing? Anyways, how did I discuss rap? Whenever I think of sandwiches, I think of rap. Wrapping sandwiches, and then we get into the rap. Anyways, that's another story. So the point being is, one can say, I can easily emulate. So what does this Quran sound like? So that I can write 10 words that sound like the Quran and finish. We say it is a lot more than that. The Quran is not rhythm, it's not rhyme, by the way. It's not about rhyming. You'll find a lot of verses, in fact, most of it that doesn't rhyme at the end. One will finish with mu'mineen, other one with ya'lamun, one with different words, different ending. Wa huwa al-ghafur al-rahim. It does not have to have the same rhyme. Nor is it following any type of structure in the poetry rules and regulations, you know, verse and pose and all that stuff, and especially in Arabic. It has its own unique elements, and this is what made it miraculous. Because the Arabs were like, look, this is neither regular writing, like essay type, nor is it poetry. It's something in between which we human beings can't seem to write. And this is why the Arabic is an important element of the miraculous nature of the Quran. You may say, well, okay, then that means that your religion is restricted to Arabs. True or false? Islam is restricted to Arabs. True or false? False? How many Arabs do we have here? How many Muslims do we have here? So obviously, the Arabs are a minority. If they gathered against us, they would beat us up and would be gone. Hopefully nobody will do that. So how is it then that we have less Arab Muslims than non-Arab Muslims? Well, that just goes to prove that it is not a restricted religion to the Arabs. Reason being, first, human beings have the capability to translate from Arabic to their respective language, and human beings have the capability to learn a new language. So either you don't speak Arabic, so you learn it to understand the Quran in its original revelation, or someone who speaks both languages on your behalf translates the Arabic to your language so you understand. It doesn't matter which direction. Of course, the better one is the first, that you learn Arabic, because then it will have a completely different impact on you. But worst case scenario, we're unable to achieve that, that's not an issue. We have the means to translate the information to our respective languages. And therefore, it is not only for the Arabs. In fact, even when you translate the Quran to English or Malay or any other language, you will lose some aspects of the miraculous nature that are related to Arabic only, but you will not lose the miraculous nature of the information in the Quran. The unbelievable accuracy of the Quran, the scientific aspects of the Quran, the historical aspects of the Quran, whether speaking about past events that took place that no one knew, or futuristic events which we are seeing today, things that will happen that we are experiencing, we either recently experienced or we are experiencing now or we will experience in the future. The Quran deals with all of that. So I wanted to share with you some examples in regards to this particular issue. Because the challenge is, did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam write or author the Quran? That is really the main issue for a lot of people. Okay, it sounds nice and whatever, but we just say that he was a human genius. Yeah? The counter argument is, he's a genius. Yes, he did write all these things which we human beings are unable to need, but it was still his own work. It was not revealed by God to him. And answering that can become quite easy if you go through the whole Quran and you realize that no matter how intelligent a human being is, it is impossible to have this type of consistency. How many pages are in the Quran? How many ayat are in the Quran? Who knows? 6,500? Is that a discounted price? Who knows how many verses? Roughly, I don't want an exact number. What is this, that 666 stuff, Akhi? 666, I've never heard that number, but it sounds interesting. Even if that were the number, do we have an issue with that? I mean, of course, some superstitious people say, devil, that's a dinosaur, sign of the devil, that proves that the Quran is not from God. Barakallahu fiik, that already creates problems. No, that is not the right number. Huh? Who knows? Yes, sir?
6,236.
Does it matter? It doesn't matter. What matters is that how many verses do we have? That was a nice deal, huh? After wasting all this time. I don't care about the number anyways. I was just teasing you guys. No, really. What we care for is the number. Once you say 6,000 and above, then you say, wait a second. 6,000? If you had to write anything that had to have 6,000 verses, consistency is an issue. Avoiding conflict and contradiction is even a bigger issue. It's humanly impossible. And if you did it all in one shot, you know, it makes it easier because you're sitting down and every time you write a new verse, you say, wait, let me go back 2,000 verses above to make sure that what I said over there is consistent with what I'm saying now. Still very difficult, right? But at least, I mean, if you're a genius, you're reading 2,000 verses up and down to make sure that the message is communicated efficiently and it's competing each other. What if it was over 23 years and you couldn't read or write? How impossible is it to make sure that you're consistent, that there's no loophole in your message? Because as soon as you make a mistake, they're going to say, aha, busted. And it's over. It's over. Do you realize how the magnitude of what I'm saying right now? This is what the Prophet Muhammad, this is the challenge he had to meet. But it is very easy to meet because he was simply receiving revelation from God, which he was conveying. It was not his job to maintain accuracy, to maintain consistency, to make sure that there's harmony. It was not his job. His job was to relay the information from God. Who managed this project in the ultimate way? The Creator himself. To show us that at a human level, you cannot do it. If all of us came together right now to try to do this, to author a book like the Quran, wherein we're going to mention the story of a professor, okay? Since this is related to the campus, we're going to mention the stories of all the professors of this university. And this story is going to be spread out in the book of 6,000 plus verses. It's going to be, or how, 600 pages? How many pages in the Quran? Around 500 something, right? So 500 page book. We want to spread out the story of this professor in many different chapters. And they have to complete each other. What are the chances of making mistakes? Very high, even though there's huge manpower, many brains thinking at the same time. The end result will be that after we finish the book, we'll send it to Nottingham University in the UK, since they're more, you know, English efficient, and then they will do a revision and editing to find how many mistakes? Hundreds of mistakes. Grammatical mistakes, sentence structure mistakes, consistency mistakes, they will pull out. After they're done, then you send it to a professor who's professional in this, then he will pull out another 100 mistakes. And the list goes on and on. In fact, every time we revise this book, we will continue to find issues. It will never reach perfection. It will never reach perfection. Why? Human made. This is what the Quran challenges the people with. The Quran is not open for this discussion. It is open, but no one can do anything about it. That's why we have never in our Islamic history had a revised version of the Quran. Never did the Muslims say, wait a second, there's some issues in this book. This verse is not making sense with that other one over there. So we need to remove one of them. Otherwise, it's going to cause confusion. Or this one has been proven scientifically to be incorrect, right? Because now people refer to science over revelation, even though as was communicated to me that in yesterday's lectures, we were reminded that science changes all the time. And that is something that is so obvious. It's crazy that people just don't get it. Science is constantly changing. We've seen it in our lifespan. Within your 20-year-old lifespan, 25, you've seen already how many changes have happened to science from what was a theory to becoming a fact and vice versa. So how are we going to evaluate the validity of revelation as per science when science is inconsistent? It's not a benchmark to begin with. The benchmark is revelation. And I will then judge science as per revelation. And I will often find harmony. Provided that scientific fact was valid, you will find harmony with the scripture, harmony with the Quran. If there's a conflict, trust me, science is wrong. Science is wrong. Because science is based on the mind of the one who was thinking about it. Maybe he had too much vodka that night. Seriously, do you think that all these scientists, they don't drink, they don't smoke? You know what I mean by smoke? Not cigarettes. Do you think there's some sort of angels? Don't you think maybe he needed to go to the bathroom while he was writing this, you know, scientific fact of his? And because of the bathroom, he just wrote it quickly, it's fine. We'll change it next year. All of these are possibility of human beings. Human beings. And then once that scientist comes out with his own theory, Darwinism for example, how many other scientists refute him? Not even religious people. Now other scientists say, get out of here, man. You don't know what you're talking about. You miss on ABC and you don't have this understood and blah, blah, blah. Scientists now start eating each other up. We're just watching. This proves that science cannot be used to judge the validity of the Quran. It's the other way around. But when we go back to the topic, which is the Quran, you will find that miraculous nature in the Quran from every aspect of life that proves that it cannot be emulated. Here's an example of the consistency or the accuracy of the Quran. When Allah spoke about Zakariya is one of the prophets. Allah mentioned about his wife or his woman. And we will see. Let me just give you the ayah. In Surah Maryam, Mary, Allah said about him, he said, وَكَانَتْ إِمْرَأَتِي عَاقِرًا فَهَبْ لِي مِنْ لَدُنْكَ وَلِيًّا. Zakariya was begging Allah to grant him a child. To grant him a child. So he said, and my woman is barren. So grant me from you a child. And the term used here to describe his wife was what? Imra'ati, which is a generic term for woman. My lady, if you want. Maybe my woman sounds a little too much for the feminist world, right? My woman, what? Well, what do you say? Yeah, my man and my woman. So my lady is barren. And the term used was lady. Then you go in another surah, Surah Al-Anbiya, it says, وَزَكَرِيَّا إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ رَبِّ لَا تَذَرْنِي فَرْدًا وَأَنْتَ خَيْرُ الْوَارِثِينَ فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُ يَحْيَى وَأَصْلَحْنَا لَهُ زَوْجَهُ. And mentioned Zakariya when he called on his Lord and he said, my Lord, do not leave me alone. Do not mean leave me without progeny, without children. And you are the best of inheritors. So Allah said, so we responded to his supplication, we answered his supplication, and we granted him Yahya. Yahya is the name of his son. وَأَصْلَحْنَا لَهُ زَوْجَهُ. And we rectified his wife, his spouse. Why did the Quran use the term my lady when speaking about his wife being barren? And then when it came to the idea of them having a child, the term spouse or wife was used. You may overlook something like this, but this is actually something of interest. Because they say, and you can ask married couples who don't have children, there's a huge difference in the relationship between two couples with children and two couples with no children. For that wife term to be most applicable, then having children is part of the process. Whereas, you don't call, for example, if you have a girlfriend, and that's not my business right now, but when a person has a girlfriend, he does not call her his wife. Why? Because there's no child involved. And there's no marriage obviously involved. But the process is that she'll be my lady. My lady. Usually when there's a child involved, then he usually marries her, then she becomes his wife. So when his wife was unable to produce children, she wasn't able to bear children, she was barren, the Quran or Allah used the term Imra'a. كانت إمرأتي عاقرة, my spouse. And then once she became capable, because Allah rectified her medical illness, to bear children, then the term zawja was used. And even though this may be subtle, the Quran signifies the type of relationship and the human psychology of when children are involved, the type of harmony that is supposed to exist between husband and wife. This is why usually, not always, but if one of the spouses is unable to produce children, very often the marriage ends. If a woman really wants children and her husband is unable to have children, then very often she says, I love you and everything, but I want children. I've always dreamt of having children, and this is something you cannot fulfill for me. And she is right for this need. She has the right to make this request. Because love is one thing, and then, you know, that life that we're living and reality and nature, natural existence is another thing. And vice versa. So this is one example where the Quran highlights this subtle difference, and this is from the linguistic, miraculous nature of the Quran. Here's another amazing one. Allah said, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَوْلِيَاءِ كَمَثَلِ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ اتَّخَذَتْ بَيْتًا وَإِنَّ أَوْهَنَ الْبُيُوتِ لَبَيْتُ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. The example of those who have taken besides Allah, deities, helpers, assistants, meaning anyone who worships anyone other than the Creator, that could be an idol, it could be a statue, it could be a prophet, it could be an angel, anyone who takes some sort of God other than their real God, if they have taken that choice, their example is like that of the spider. A spider who has taken a home. Then the ayah says, and verily, the most fragile of homes is the home of the spider, if they only knew. Who can depict the miraculous aspect in this verse? I know it's a little difficult, but let's give it a shot so we can be interactive. Again, the example of those who have taken besides Allah gods, some sort of God, they are like the spider who has taken a home. And what is the home of the spider made of? What? Bricks? Wood? From what? From a web, right? From a website? And verily the most fragile of homes is the home of the spider, if you only know. Where is the miraculous nature in this verse? Yes, sir. I don't know what you've been reading, Akhi. Female spider, male spider? There's no mention of male and female here. Nice try. Try again. Anyone else? Okay, I'll give you a hint. The house of the spider, this is the web. What does it take for you to destroy it? Right? Flick? Blowing at it? Is that enough? Or you need to bring a hammer, caterpillar, you know, tools and everything just to break it down? It's very flimsy, right? Like this, khalas, it's gone. But the actual, the web itself, the silk material that the spider produces, they say it is not as strong, but it's very close to steel. The strength of the actual web itself, not the whole house, but the web, the lines, the silk that the spider produces to make the web, according to scientists, not me, and you can Google this at your own convenience. Some say it's stronger than steel. The scientists say, no, not really. But it has the same tensile pressure, which is the highest pressure any fabric can maintain before it breaks. And the Quran does not say, that the web, that meaning that material itself, the silk itself, is the most flimsy or the most fragile, because the Quran maintains the strength of that. But what is the one that the Quran describes as being fragile? The whole web, which we all agree that you can blow at it and it's gone. Do you see? Because it could have been the khayt. The word which is used could have been the actual thread itself. But the Quran made no mention of the thread, because that thread is actually among the strongest material that a creature can produce. Almost as strong as steel. And how strong is steel? Do you get it? Or did I lose you somewhere along the lines? If I lost you, meet me outside. No one got that joke? I'll keep the jokes to myself next time. Here's another one. And who's, let's try to challenge the Arabs. Since they are the Arabs. Tafarraqu wa tatafarraqu. Can anyone share with us any insight? What is the difference between these two words? Mawlana.
Tafarraqu means that in the action is shared between me and someone else. I separate and he separates as well. Tatafarraqu.
Are you done?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Can you repeat? What's the difference between tafarraqu and tatafarraqu? Are they synonymous?
No.
Okay, what's the difference? How many letters are added?
One letter.
One additional letter. Right? So if we wanted to, for those who don't speak Arabic, can you think of an English word or anything in English that we can relate to? Where you add one letter, but the meaning is almost the same? No? How about negligent and negligence? For example, right? It's all trying to deliver the same meaning, right? But depending on what you're describing, then you can either say, this person is negligent, and he suffers from negligence. Are we on the same page? Or even English is not working right now. So I can try Chinese, which I don't speak. Yes, sir. Ziyada? Aywa? Here's the sheikh right there. Actually, that one additional letter, and Arabic is different than English, signifies a different meaning than the original one, even though for the average Arab, these are synonymous words. Whether you say tafarraqu or tatafarraqu, at the end speaking about dividing. Divide. Let me give you the context so you will see the difference. And the first one, Allah said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبِّ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. All you have believed, be mindful of Allah and fear Him the way He deserves it, and do not die except in the state of submission as Muslims. And hold on to the rope of Allah altogether, all Muslims. Huh? Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, all you have believed, all believers, hold on to the rope of Allah altogether. What is the rope of Allah? The Quran or the religion itself. And do not divide. Wala tafarraqu. Now let's read the ayah where tatafarraqu was mentioned. شَرَعَ لَكُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا وَصَّى بِهِ نُوحًا وَالَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ وَمَا وَصَّيْنَا بِهِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمُوسَى وَعِيسَى أَنْ أَقِيمُوا الدِّينَ وَلَا تَتَفَرَّقُوا فِيهِ. He has enjoined upon you, Muslims, of the religion, what he enjoined upon Noah. And what he advised the prophets before that, like Abraham, excuse me, and Moses and Jesus, that you should establish this religion and do not divide therein. But the first one is وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, and now وَلَا تَتَفَرَّقُوا. All you have is an additional ta. But linguistically, this has a reason behind it. Why? In the first ayah, Allah was addressing the Muslim ummah, that they should be like a single structure. And in the second one, and therefore that additional meaning, because we're speaking to one nation, was not needed. So there's only one ta, la tafarraqu. But when Allah spoke about the previous nations, where He mentioned what he advised Moses and Jesus and Abraham and Noah, how many nations do we have now? Many nations. So now it is ideal that you have an additional ta, because now you're speaking about multiple nations. So one nation, لا تفرقوا. Multiple nations, لا تتفرقوا. Do you understand? Now again, many people don't know this because they simply read the Quran for other objectives. But those who look into this aspect of the Quran, they have thousands of examples to prove that it is so accurate, it is so precise, so concise, it is humanly impossible for any human being to be able to write it with this type of consistency. Another example. When the Quran rearranges the words in the sentence structure in order to emphasize certain meaning over another, which is known as hasr. Hasr is exclusivity. This may apply in the English language, but in a very limited form. But in Arabic, this is a very famous way of approaching an important topic. In fact, we can think of English examples as well. When someone wants to fight for a cause, and you know, they have these people that lead the protest, right? What do they usually scream about? The thing which they scream for when they give them that speaker. What is the thing that they try to highlight in the beginning? If someone was imprisoned, if someone was imprisoned from among their activists, they give him that speaker to scream in the street so he can get arrested afterwards. But what is it that, what would be the first thing he would say?
Freedom.
Freedom, right? Freedom! Freedom, that would be the main slogan. Then he will have a sign that says, free batatas mashah, free kebab al-lahm, free whatever his name is. Of course, that's not the name of a person. But the actual most important word that is communicated is what? The freedom, because that's, he doesn't begin by giving you the whole thing. This morning, we would like to call for Mr. Muhammad to be freed. Would that have the same impact on the people? No. When you say freedom, freedom, or in, you know, in war, or well, they're gonna think we're military again. Dang it, I can't give that example. But you know, usually in war, right? They scream the thing which will get everybody excited, then they tell us the rest of the story. Why? Because that exclusivity will deliver that message to you. And the Quran, when it comes to maintaining the right of Allah, anytime in the Quran you want to discuss the right of God being worshipped alone, having zero partners, you will always find this type of exclusivity in the choice of words, in the sentence structure, beginning with the Fatiha. Linguistically, you're supposed to say, after Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Malik Yawm Al-Din, linguistically you're supposed to say, Na'buduka Wahdak, Wa Nasta'inu Bik, Ihdina Sirat Al-Mustaqim. That's what you're supposed to say linguistically, purely linguistically, with the standard structure. But what does the Quran say? Iyaka, Iyaka what? Na'budu, Wa Iyaka, Nasta'in. Do you know why? Why are you saying, it is only you we worship? Notice the difference. We worship you alone. We worship you alone. Where's the emphasis on what? We. Your mind is thinking, who are you? Huh? What about you? When you say we, meaning you as in the group. Versus saying, it is only you we worship. Where's the emphasis? You're thinking, who is who? Who is this you that you're worshipping? Now the emphasis is no longer on us, it is on the one whom we're worshipping. Why? By merely changing the structure of the sentence. What do we begin with? And so the Quran, in order to highlight, this is very subtle, but it's amazing. So that you will always bear in mind that if everything is done for the sake of God, don't forget. Don't even bother saying, we worship you alone, or say, it is you alone who we worship. And it is you alone from whom we seek aid. And the examples in the Quran are numerous to highlight this. Why? Because the Quran is meant The main message of the Quran is what? Connecting people with who? With their Lord. The Quran is to connect each one of us on his own personal level with his Lord. That's why the language of the Quran is not like the language of some guy speaking to you. It is not the language of a third party. Very often it is God speaking directly to you. Ya ayyuhal insan, ma gharraka bi rabbikal kareem. That ayah by itself is amazing. When Allah says in his own book, oh human being, what has deluded you concerning your most noble Lord? What is causing you to keep going zigzag and up and down and sidetracking? What? الَّذِي خَلَقَكَ فَسَوَّاكَ فَعَدَلَكَ فِي أَيِّ سُورَةٍ مَا شَاءَ رَكَبَكَ. The one who created you and fashioned you and put you together in the image that he wanted, he formed you. Did any one of you customize himself before he came? Did your parents go on some website? I want big nose, small ears, long hair? Huh? Has any one of you had a choice in what he looks like? Most people are not happy with the way they look, right? So they go through, you know, plastic surgery and all type of stuff, and some people explore in the process. Especially the other gender, when they try to do silly things that they don't need to do. But the point being, no one has a choice. You human being always complaining, talking about God is not good enough. Why does God want to be worshipped? Why do I have to even obey God? Why do I have to pray? Why do I have to fast? And God is telling you, what has made you make this choice? You didn't create yourself. You didn't have any choice in it. You had no opinion regarding this. Everything was managed by him and is being managed by him up until this moment. You don't control your heart. You don't control your mind. You don't control the blinking of your eye. If God wants you to blink, you will blink even if you try not to blink. Nothing. Nothing. No control over anything. You can eat the next meal and get poisoned and die. Food poison and die. True or false? Can anyone say I'm above and beyond? No, I know from the moment I see this plate that there's a cockroach in there. Can anyone claim this stuff? No one can do this. You are so vulnerable. Human beings are so vulnerable to the one storm, one tornado, one tsunami, we're all gone. One earthquake, we're all gone. At the same minute, the biggest, buffest guy and the weakest guy, they will die next to each other. No one can do anything about it. Why? Because we have such vulnerability towards the Creator. And when the Quran speaks to you in this language, telling you, why are you deluded? Why are you doing this? Why are you fighting your Lord? So the ayat after, كَلَّا بَلْ تُكَذِّبُونَ بِالدِّينِ, but you deny the religion. After all of this, knowing that you're helpless and you can't do anything, you don't control anything, in spite of all of that, human beings want to reject the religion of God. وَإِنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ لَحَافِظِينَ, while they are actually guardian angels writing down everything that you do. يَعْلَمُونَ مَا تَفْعَلُونَ, they know what you do. Then Allah told us the bottom line, إِنَّ الْأَبْرَارَ لَفِي نَعِيمٍ, verily the righteous people are in ultimate delight. The God-conscious people are in ultimate delight. In this world and in the life to come. In this world because he knows why he was created. He knows where he's going. He knows that he will be tested. He knows there are calamities. He knows he will lose loved ones. He already is prepared mentally for all the disasters in the world. Why? We were told. And we believe that they're managed by God. And he is more merciful to us than we are to ourselves. We can cope with it. Nobody said you're not going to cry, you won't be sad. No. It's part of the process. But you're mentally, psychologically ready to deal with these issues. So you are in a peace of mind. You have a peace of mind in this life. And obviously after you die. On the flip side, وَإِنَّ الْفُجَّارَ لَفِي جَحِيمٍ, the evil, corrupt people, they will be in that eternal burning fire. Both in this life and in the life to come. In this life, because nothing satisfies them. Desires, following desires. They're just jumping around from this to that. When calamity strikes, they don't cope. If they believe in God, why me? Why did you do this to me? How can there be a loving God and then my son, you know, dies? How can be a passionate God and there are people dying in this country? How can they? And they're constantly confused. They don't have anything solid to stand on. And then in the life to come, matters will even become worse. And I'm only giving you one example of the Quran. I can share more. But what I really want is that we, human beings, you students, people of intellect, people of education, if the educationalists and the intellectualists and people at your level who are actually studying don't interact with revelation to analyze it, then who will do it? The people that have to work every day from 9 to 5, that have no time for themselves, no time for anything, just to earn a living? Who may not be able to read, write, or have very low IQ, they don't understand the message, they cannot communicate with it at that level? So, you know, people at your level are the most qualified to analyze this Quran. Read it. Especially for the non-Muslims. I may talk from now until tomorrow, and all the Muslims can give you many lectures. Don't worry about us. Take your own time and read it. And see how you will find if you are seeking salvation. Some people don't want it, and if they don't want it, there's nothing you can do about it. Your boss can warn you 100 times that doing this type of thing will get you fired, and if you don't care, you will get fired. If you take heed, you will keep your job. If you don't care, you'll get fired. Some people are meant to get fired. It's just the way it is. So it's your choice at the end of the day. But if you're open-minded, if you're neutral, and you read the Quran, I don't think anyone can reject it afterwards. And this is what happened to the people at the time of the Prophet Muhammad. That's why they did not want them to hear the Quran. Because when they heard the Quran, they fell in submission to God. They knew that this was the speech of the Creator. So, the eternal challenge will be eternal. I stand here or sit here before you today, maybe 20 years from now, 200 years from now, 2,000 years from now, Allah knows. Another person may be addressing a different crowd, different speaker with different crowd, repeating the same topic, and would be saying the same thing, which I said today, that someone might have said 1,000 years ago, that this Quran, this challenge can never be met. Therefore, all human beings, take heed and return to your Lord. So that is my message to you. Take heed and return to your Lord. I thank you for your patience and for hearing me out. And I guess we can have questions and answers where I ask the questions and you give me the answers. No? Okay, I guess not.
JazakAllah khair, Brother Abu Mus'ab. May Allah reward you for this breathtaking lecture. And for now, we'll be going for the Q&A session. So we have till
tomorrow.
10 p.m. inshallah. So I'd like to start with the male side.
Okay, ladies first. We'll start with the ladies.
Okay, the speaker was the ladies first, the ladies first.
I'm just trying to be nice and everything, you know? Only today.
So from the ladies' side, any questions? If not, you can pass down a written question if you do not want to speak on the mic.
Yeah, anyone who's not comfortable asking, you can write it down. And if the ladies are not ready, then the gentleman can ask.
Okay, gentlemen.
I think it was a feminist who came up with the idea, ladies and gentlemen. You never hear gentlemen and ladies. Welcome to this event. Why? I don't know, man. They say that we're being, you know. Anyways, we'll discuss that later.
So, gentlemen, any questions?
We have a brother right here. He wants to eat. He can go like this. I got some coffee, brother. Until we find the questioner, I'll tell you a joke. So, a husband said to his wife, "How are you?" She said, "I'm fine." Thank you.
Please ask questions.
That was so funny. Can I say it again? That was original, huh? You can use it, it's okay. No copyright. But if someone punches you, I'm not responsible. Yes, sir.
Assalamualaikum.
Salam.
Sheikh, you have made mention sometimes like Jesus, Abraham, Moses. So what are the stands in Islam? I made mention some names like Jesus, Abraham, Moses, and rest.
Yeah, what's
their stand position in Islam? Are they with prophet, messengers, or reality about the things and Islam particularly?
Yeah, well, I mean, Islam, as we've said in previous talks, Islam is unique in a sense that it's the only religion which makes it an article of faith to believe in all the messengers of God. You cannot possibly reject one, because the rejection of one is equal to the rejection of all. So any prophet which has been mentioned in the Quran, some of which have been mentioned by name, some of which were not mentioned by name, it doesn't matter. We believe in all of them. Now, some of them were prophets, which is this level, and messenger is a level above the prophethood. Because he is first, he's a prophet as in he received divine contact, and a messenger, he actually has to now deliver a message to his people. So Jesus was a messenger. Abraham was a messenger. Noah was a messenger. Moses was a messenger. And Prophet Muhammad was a messenger. In fact, these are known as the Ulul Azmi min al-Rusul, those of strong determination. They were the best messengers among the many messengers. We believe in them equally. We love them equally. And, you know, we have nothing but respect for them.
May Allah reward you. I received some questions from the sister's side and I'm going to read it on. The first question is, I agree that the Quran contains the truth.
Thank you.
But why should I change my life according to it when I'm completely happy with my current way of life?
Good question. Good question. That is because happiness is of two types. Real happiness and temporary fake happiness. When you get drunk, which one is it? Which type of happiness is it? The real happiness or the temporary happiness? Temporary. When you get high, same thing. Temporary. Anything that you do which may produce some sort of entertainment, you have to first analyze whether this type of entertainment or happiness, is it genuine and real? Or is it beneficial in the long run? Or is it short term? So I agree, you may be happy without the Quran. But that happiness that you are enjoying now is because nothing has happened that will change your current status. The Quran is meant to be there to help you go through difficult times. And we know that difficult times will eventually come. It might not be now. But when they come, then all the happiness will go away and you have nothing to return to. So the Quran or the Islam, submission to God, let me just say it in general words, helps you cope with both times. And it's the only one that can generate real, genuine happiness. That happiness is not money related. It's not materialistically related to material, I'm sorry. It is a type of happiness that emanates from the heart. Even if you're poor, even if you lost your job, even if some other things happen, still, there's contentment inside. Whereas we have billionaires who are depressed and committing suicide. Even though we believe, what, I mean, you have all the money, are you kidding me? Someone who's a billionaire, who can technically buy any car, any minute, and just go for a ride. Don't you think for any one of us, right now, if somebody told you, how about you drive this Ferrari around the campus? Would that make you happy? Of course. Your heart would be beating fast and you'd be sitting in the car like this and take a picture, selfie with the whole thing, you know, with that stupid selfie stick. People walking around, falling off the cliff, taking a selfie. You heard the news? Yeah, I need the selfie stuff, I don't know, man. It's called selfie. The closest word to selfie is selfish. But anyways, I'll get off the selfies and the selfie people. How did I get here? Yeah, so you'll be happy about the car. you know, $2 million, and now you have to pay to fix it. What will happen to your happiness? It will vanish. It will turn to what? Depression. Whereas the one who follows the Quran, he's like the one who's sitting on his bicycle. And he doesn't have a Ferrari, and he doesn't have to worry about it. He doesn't have to be, he's content with the bicycle. He doesn't need something that will make him so happy that eventually goes away, he becomes sad again. He's content with the bicycle. So he has a peace of mind. So you can live without the Quran for some duration of time thinking you're happy, but trust me, a time will come where if you don't have this Quran as part of the equation in your lifestyle, you will no longer be happy. And this is just regarding the worldly life. In the life to come, I guarantee you, you will not be happy. Because if you believe, if you said, I'm using your words, the Quran is truthful, then the Quran told you that if you don't act according to the regulations of God, then in the life to come, you will not be happy. So if you believe in the Quran, you have to believe that too. And so you're contradicting yourself. So you can do it. You can maintain happiness while following the Quran, inshallah.
JazakAllah khair.
Barakallah.
Excuse me. Any questions from the floor? Brothers or?
Yes.
I am an agnostic, like instant doubt or something like that.
No problem, welcome.
Yeah. So my question is, as just now you said, like we are so vulnerable and stuff that we don't really even like control our next blink and this kind of things. Where you know we don't really like get to decide what we are being inputted with, like being. Input like I mean as in education or I mean ideology kind of things. How do you think that like we are still like responsible for our actions, things like that?
Understood. Yeah. Good question. What I was referring to earlier does not conflict with the idea that we have self-reliance and responsibility. I'm saying they are two sides of the coin. One side of the coin is your ability, your strength, your willingness, and all the other elements which are God-given, by the way, where you have to do your part. And then on the other side of the coin is the part where you have no control. Meaning, you want to go from destination A to destination B. You may have the vehicle, you may have GPS, you may be smart, you have a sense of direction. You have all the tools that God gave you to arrive at destination B. But can you guarantee that you will arrive there? No, you cannot. So the fact that you cannot guarantee, does that mean that you don't use GPS, you don't use your brain, you don't use a vehicle? No. We're not telling you to sit there and say, well, I guess there's no point in going anywhere because I cannot guarantee whether I will arrive there or not. You understand? No, go ahead. Use all the means that God gave you, but know that you have no control. You may go to start the car, it doesn't run. Your GPS battery may go out. Something happens on the way that hinders your path. This is the element that you cannot control. But that which is within our human capability, then we're supposed to utilize it to the fullest to achieve our goals and achievements in life. Clear? That was a good question. Feel free to ask more. Yes, sir. Hey!
Welcome, sir. How
are you? Salam.
Okay, I've got a small question.
How small is it? That small?
No, actually, it's not that small, if I'm being honest. This is this comes up usually when you're, debating religion with people of other faith and, people who have no faith in that matter. But I'm going to stick to the topic that we had today. And, you said that the strongest and the most common argument. The best argument that can be given to anyone to prove that the word of Quran is actually from God and it's legit,
okay,
is that no one can reproduce something similar to it, even close to it.
Okay.
Right? So when I use that argument or try to convince someone with it, say that there cannot be anything that can be written close to the Quran. So a lot of my friends are agnostic. They would bring up the scriptures and poetry and books written by many intelligent people over the time, and they'd say, look at how intelligent these books are, and look at how intelligently these scriptures and these books have been written on. And people from different faith would bring up the same argument, saying that our book is just as good and it's been written. I heard your whole argument, and how there are things that I said about the future, and some things that have been interpreted in the way that that it's so intelligent that it could not have been written by a person that has to be from the God who created us. But at the same time, there are other scriptures, and people try to prove. My basic question is, who's going to be the judge of this? How do we judge if I'm arguing with a person who's not from the same faith? How do I convince that person going that, there has to be some sort of a standard, what I mean?
Okay, understood. Well, first I just want to clarify one thing you said, which is that they show you other works of history and whatever and say that these are intelligent. We did not say that only the Quran is intelligent and everything else is not. We maintain that human beings are creative, they are smart, and they have put together a lot of literature, a lot of art that is praiseworthy, that we appreciate as well. So we're not undermining these facts. However, we're speaking about superiority, and we're speaking about consistency and accuracy. That aspect, human beings fail in doing. So if you read Shakespeare, if you believe in Shakespeare, or any artist, you will find that they have their ups and downs. There were times when they were criticized by the people for not being, they cannot always perform at the same level. Any athlete, any artist, even in the Olympics, one time they get a full score when they jump something, the next time they fall and break their leg. So the issue is inconsistency. We're saying that the Quran is unique, that it is consistent. It's consistent in high performance. That no one else can prove. And then if they say, no, we can prove it, then let them bring their scripture. You understand what I'm saying? Bring the Bible, bring the Torah, bring the scriptures of the Hindus and the Buddhists or whatever, and then we go through as an analytical study, and you will find, as already done by different debaters all over the world, that only the Quran survives all these tests. I mean, the most popular other book after the Quran would be what? The Bible. True or false? There are more Christians in the world than any other followers of Christianity, than any other faith. More so than Muslims. So before we go into the smaller religions which have not even gained as much popularity, or agnosticism or atheism, which is also a new trend in a sense that is becoming more prevalent. Before it was abnormal, now it's becoming the normal, and being religious is abnormal, and things are changing. But we don't say that they were never atheists, they've always been atheists and agnostics, but it wasn't prevalent. The prevalent thing was people believed in God. Who God was, what scripture they followed, that's where the difference was. So setting those aside, let's just go Quran and the Bible. From the very beginning, from stage one, how many Bibles do we have? According to how many denominations, with how many scriptures, how many books within the scripture, how many contradictions, how many additions, how many deletions, how many insertions, how many revisions, it's done already. We've already lost. The Bible already lost. And the Quran, when we ask the same questions, we'll say none, null, null, zero, 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 one version, one Quran, one language, no revision, no editing, there's no, this Quran for this denomination, that Quran for that denomination. It's one Quran. Even though the Muslims may differ and make groups in interpreting it, it remains to be one Quran. It's over. If you dig deeper now about the stories of the prophets, then you'll find in the Quran the prophets are consistently being praised and appreciated and described as the best, the best of God's creation. Whereas if you look at the Bible, you find that the prophets were sleeping with their daughters, they were alcoholics, they were doing, and these are in the Bible. It's sad, but they're in the Bible. Noah, Prophet Lot, Prophet Lut, as we call him in Arabic, many other prophets, the stories in the Bible are crazy about things that we would even be considered to be abnormal or hideous for us. So you know, if you dig deep, it becomes clear the Quran cannot be matched or compared with any literature that is non-religious, let alone religious scripture. Yeah, go ahead, but we cannot stay till tomorrow. So give it one last input.
No, the thing is, I'm still a little, you know, here and there, but for example, you said consistency, right? And I'm saying this because I've had this debate with a few friends before, and sometimes you fall short of points, you know,
okay.
Arguments to make. So the first thing is that consistency. There have been books written with 10 parts and, you know, 1,000 pages each book, and, you know, Harry Potter series things for the sake of it, right? And then there is consistency, there is character, and each character has a life and all that. So if an argument like that is put forward. Now about the other religions, you know...
Sorry, I have to answer that one.
Yeah.
Harry Potter?
No, I'm not comparing it at all. I'm just saying consistency sort of a thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But even those who are in favor of Harry Potter, they will tell you at the end of the day what? It's a modern book about magic and the whole shebang, and with no followers. But whereas the Quran has produced, you know, people that follow this faith and submit to God and pray five times a day, and, you know, a lifestyle has been completely altered, for especially for reverts who come from some religion to Islam. Their appearance changed, their lifestyle changed, their behavior changed with the Quran. What does Harry Potter do?
I'm just speaking in terms of consistency.
Are you arguing on your behalf or on their behalf?
I'm asking, like, how do you respond to
something? I'm giving you a response, so digest it. First, before we jump to the next one, because your mind, there's a communication barrier because you're thinking about the next point. Before we jump to the next point, did you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So if someone, they, your friends, told you Harry Potter versus the Quran, say, hey, calm down, my friend. Come on, who are you fooling here? Because this is something that is modern, and it's a book about, you know, whatever. We're not denying that it doesn't have some art to it, but what has it done to humankind in terms of impacting them positively? We win already. And anything similar to Harry Potter, you will give the similar answer. It's not just about the Quran's consistency, it's about how does it reflect in the lives of people? What does it produce in the society? So the Quran is the one that makes me, if my mother right now were to call me on the phone and tell me, Abu Musab, get off the stage right now and go get me a cup of water, what will I do? It's my religion, the Quran, that tells me that I will abandon you lovely people and obey my mom, because my mom has such a right over me. Where does this type of idea come from morality point of view? The Quran's message. Harry Potter is not going to do that. You understand? It may make you pull out a rabbit from a hat or something, but it's not going to impact you in a moral way, in a positive way towards the society. Because we all agree that mothers have rights. Otherwise, they wouldn't have invented Mother's Day. Right? So, I mean, you have to go down with them to this level. Then you will find that the Quran is still unparalleled, unmatched. Or next time, just call me on the phone, I'll talk to them.
When you say science is not reliable, is that only applicable to religion and God? What about science in terms of the studies of psychology, medicine, etc., which human beings rely on? Is science not reliable in these?
No, not always.
If so...
Oh, you're not done? Sorry. Talk about being excited.
If so, why would we study medicine, psychology, to further understand the human beings and their behavior, etc.?
Okay, understood. No one is insinuating that we should abandon science, abandon medicine, abandon studies. That is not what I was trying to prove. All I was trying to say is that we don't want to give science a privilege or prestige higher than revelation. That's all I'm saying. If I'm confronted with two sources, scientific source versus religious revelation based, let me be specific, Quran or Sunnah source, then I as a believer will give precedence to the revelation over science. Why? This is by God, preserved by God, the creator of all things. This is by a human being who's known for being, for changing his mind. It doesn't mean I will not study medicine anymore, or we should abandon all science, but this, let's say if we were to set aside the issues of the science related to religion, in regards to psychology. Now, if we ask 100 people in this hall, homosexuality, is it normal or abnormal? Honestly, you don't have to raise your hand and burn yourself out, especially if your friend is one. But in this one room, you will find people that will, you know, with courage and bravery, say it's an abnormal stance on life, while others will say the opposite. So, what? How does science help? You will have in psychology, some will say, no, you're sick. You're a homophobic son of a gun. And you're supposed to love all the homosexuals in the world. It's your problem. And you will find other psychologists who say, no, you're normal. And these guys got issues. They've accepted something that is, you know, an abomination unto God as being the norm. A man being with a man. Where man and man created to be together in the way physically we are? No, not really. But you can make it work. You can make a lot of things work even though they're not supposed to work. So then, how can you, where is science going to help me? It's a never-ending discussion among scientists as to whether you are abnormal or normal for your stance against homosexuality. Before it was a disease, now homophobia is a disease. True or false? True. I'm telling you true. But then if I were to refer to religion, the religion puts an end to this discussion. Which is what is logical. So that would be my answer. That yes, science continues to be unsatisfactory. It does not give me all the answers. There are so many things that scientists don't know. They can't even cure so many diseases in the world. Until now, with all the advancement, with all the innovations, with all the technology, so these simple diseases, huh? They spread like that swine flu or something else. What were we able to do? Everybody was scared. People walking around with these, you know, the face masks and gloves and sanitizers all day. Right or wrong? Where were the scientists? They were get all day talking, you know, talking all this genius talk, and then when push comes to shove, you can't even protect us from a simple disease that is spreading among people, an epidemic. So we say, science has all these limitations, you see them before your eyes. If you keep following science, wherein you will reject revelation, you will reach a dead end. Give religion, revelation, a precedence over science, and continue to appreciate science. Right? I appreciate science. Every Muslim appreciates science. But I will never give it appreciation that goes beyond revelation. Because then I will be unsatisfied. Because science is simply unsatisfactory. But you can study science.
Hello?
I missed the question from the
yeah. side. I have a few concerns here. Everything you say makes perfect sense, but speaking from a non-Muslim point of view, or basically from an unusual point of view, I don't see why it seems to me that religion has become marketing. Everyone's trying to prove theirs over another one. Right? Yeah. And yet, you could as well say if someone was a strong and good Muslim, they're going to do good in the world. They're going to, I don't know, do their just part to society and then move to heaven. On the other hand, even a Christian will do the same. So for one to come up and say, I don't know, one is superior to the other, I don't get where people get that basis. And by the Quran, we want to say is superior to the Bible. I don't think it's necessary for one to state theirs is better than another. You can as well come forth and state what's good about this book, all right? And let people have to be able to pick it because they feel it's better, rather than to try and trash one to hail another. I don't think that's, say, a right way to go about it. And yeah, there is Noah and the like who had their human era, but that is from their human point of view. It had nothing to do with the divine work of God in them. It's the fact that at the end of the day, they were human beings as well. So if they did err, that was the human in them, right? And so that has nothing to relate to God himself, or it wasn't God's plan. I don't know, it wasn't God who instructed him to probably see his word or something like this. So there's that as well. So basically,
Okay. I'll comment on what you have said. I'll try to recollect the points you made and address each briefly, so that you guys won't be traumatized in the process. In regards to the issue of marketing religion, that this is something that should not necessarily be done, and that everyone should be given, you just mentioned the good about your religion without trashing others. Agreed. If you notice that throughout my lecture, at no point did I mention the Bible or anything of the sort, even though that could have been done. That was only mentioned in the context of explaining to our brother how to deal with certain arguments where in fact have to be made. And I highlighted the fact that people get emotional when you speak about their religion. And we highlighted the fact that the intellectual person is able to cope with facts instead of just being emotionally hurt about them, and therefore no positive results are made. I understand how you feel. I put myself in your shoes. If someone were to speak about the Bible and tell us about the beauty of the Bible, at some point take a swipe at the Quran, I as a Muslim would have an issue. So you could have just mentioned the Bible without mentioning the Quran. So don't think I don't feel where you're coming from. I do feel where you're coming from. But again, if that person who was speaking about the Quran had a valid point, I as a Muslim would just have to swallow it. Unless I can prove him to be wrong. And this is where the real issue is, proving some of the things which were said to be wrong. If they cannot be proven wrong, therefore we have to cope with the facts. Why do we promote Islam? And your discussion about whichever way you prefer to make the cup of tea, as long as you end up with a cup of tea, and that all religions promote goodness, and as long as you believe in God and you do good, then it's fine. That is completely incorrect. Completely incorrect, because you're suggesting that each one of us can keep his religion and end up in the same destination. And from a realistic, logical point of view, that is impossible. Reason being, the only way we can all arrive at this cup, if we had Islam, Christianity, Hinduism, Buddhism, agnosticism, atheism, and all the other isms, the only way we can end up at this particular cup, if we all had shared at least the fundamental beliefs that will allow us to go in that same direction, because we're saying that destination is the same. If we're saying the destination is different, then that's a whole other discussion. But we're assuming that we all believe that there's paradise and hell. As a Christian, you believe in paradise and hell, so the destination should be paradise or God. We don't even agree who God is. We don't agree. No two religions agree who God is. So how are we going to arrive to God if our gods are different? So it is impossible that it is merely of being good. We agree.
And sorry to cut you off, but I'd like to know the difference between Allah and God, if you may.
They're synonymous. Allah is the Arabic word for the God. And the God meaning, when we Muslims say Allah, we refer to the creator of the heavens and the earth and all things. And any idea, any human image, any statue, any idol, any object of worship that the people, human beings have invented, are excluded and do not apply to the God, the one and true God. Now, in Christianity, it's supposed to be the Father. Conceptually speaking, even though the Father in Catholicism has an image, you know, where he's given Jesus the life, or Adam, he's given Adam the life through some sort of art drawn by, I don't know what his name was, Leonardo DiCaprio? No, that was an actor. Da Vinci or something, whatever. Anyways, I don't care about that stuff. So they have attached a human imagery to the Father. But in reality, if the Christians were to abandon Father, Son, Holy Ghost, then what the Christians consider the Father is what we consider the God. And maybe in Buddhism or in Hinduism, it could be Brahman, which is that the ultimate God, that which is, you know, manifest in Shiva and this and that, all the different things. But it's the God, the ultimate God. This is who we are referring to. And so we don't agree, as you see, or if we agree that it's the God, then it is the God, or Allah, who tells us the path which leads to Him. Not that we make one of our own, wherein His rights are undermined, His rights are compromised, and say, well, I will arrive to Him a at any rate, because this is the way I like to do it. It doesn't work this way. We say it is his choice. What is his choice? What he taught Adam and Abraham and Noah and Moses and Jesus. What were they teaching? That there's only one God. And all other religions promote multiple gods.
I meant to differ.
Yes, please differ.
But if I don't know, in the interest of time, I question that probably after. Anyway, the point is, there is no different God. It's one God, the creator of everything.
Okay.
Yes.
Is he manifest in Jesus?
As the Son and as the Holy Spirit, but they're not different.
They're not different?
No, it's all one God.
So I'm sorry, wait. The Son, Holy...
God in three persons, you know? But
God in three persons.
Yeah,
listen to yourself, Malish.
God
in three persons. But you just said that we're speaking about the same God.
Yes, we are, because in the end...
But God to us is not three persons.
Sheikh Al-Musar, can I interfere?
You can interfere.
For such discussions, Brother Al-Musar will be there tomorrow. So you can spend as much time as you like and discuss with him. And we will proceed to other questions.
Okay. In your initial question, if you excuse me, you mentioned how many questions together? Two or three?
Well,
it was more of a lecture, right? Anyways, you mentioned three, right? Can you give him some time to tackle all three of them? And then we can proceed to later on discussions. Okay, thanks a lot. Okay, just for time's sake, thanks.
Anyways, until then, no hard feelings. I believe this is the best part of the lecture. This is mature talk. This is, you know, it's good to go back and forth so we can understand each other better. This is not, I'm not offended by the questions, nor do I want to attack you in responding, but, you know, we're trying to, you know, argue at a particular level, so don't get upset. We will continue this afterwards, inshallah. I'm more than happy and ready.
Please visit our booth, which is there at the SA. Brother Musa will be there. Dr. Bilal Phillips will also be there to address all of your concerns. So you can have even one-to-one meetings and private discussions with them. And inshallah.
In the presence of others. You just have to throw that out there.
Anyways, it's 10 p.m. So I would like to take permission from Musa first. Do you want to continue with the rest of the Q&A that we have, or shall we?
The way I believe is I was flown from my country here not to be spoiled. Okay, I'm here until you guys are fed up. I don't have an issue. I'm not tired.
So are you guys fed up, or should we continue?
When you're fed up, I'm fine. But I'm not. I will continue until you're done.
So
maybe they hate me for saying this now. Like, oh, just go home. No, seriously, if you guys are fed up, I'm cool. You want to continue?
Yes.
Beautiful. Wake me up when you're done.
Okay, fine. I'll address some of the questions that I received on the pieces of paper first, just to give them the view, right? How is the language of the Quran consistent in terms of ideology?
Good. Very good question. How is the language of the Quran consistent in terms of ideology? Well, the main ideology that the Quran promotes is the right of the Creator to be worshipped alone. And if you go through the verses where it speaks about the worship of Allah, then you'll find that linguistically, it is always highlighting the greatness of the Creator. So if you go through the Quran, you find that the message of the Quran is knowing your Creator. And our Creator is known through His names and attributes. His names and qualities, because we don't see God, we don't feel God. The senses which we usually use to identify other creatures don't apply to God. Therefore, the only way we get to know God is through His names and attributes. And the Quran is consistent in describing who God is at the end of the verses. So you get to know Allah, the ideology behind knowing Allah is, if you read the Quran from the beginning to end, almost what, maybe 50-60% ends with وهو الغفور الرحيم وهو العليم الحكيم. And he is the all-knowing, the all-wise. And he is the all-loving, the all-merciful. And he is the all-forgiving, the irresistible. And so on and so forth. So this ideology is promoted through language, where the Quranic verses end with teaching you who your creator is. And that is the most important element of ideology. Of course, we can elaborate more, but we want to be fair with the answer time.
I will read a couple of questions from the piece of paper first before going down to the floor. How do you deal with the misinterpretation of the Quran?
How do you deal with the misinterpretation of the Quran? Just like you deal with the misinterpretation of anything in this world. You go to a mechanic and you tell him that your car's, you know, not moving because you believe that you need to change the air filter. And then he will explain to you that you don't know about, you know, the engine, and there's nothing wrong with your air filter. You have a busted, you know, hose over here that you need to change. So the person who will deal with the misinterpretation has to have the ability to identify it and explain the proper stance. Then the misinterpretation will be gone. Anything is open for misinterpretation. Bottom line is, nothing in this world is free from being misinterpreted. But the issue is not with that which is being misinterpreted, with the misinterpreter, if that is a word. So we just fix the misinterpreter. We remove mis, and we remain with mister. No, we remove mis and we keep the interpreter, proper interpreter. My jokes are so lame, I know.
What is the role of women in Islam?
What is the role of women in Islam? Seriously? There's more?
And what do you think of feminism?
Well, I don't know. Didn't we discuss this more? This is a bomb. This is not a question.
In your opinion, is it compatible with religion?
Okay. I don't know, how many years have we been doing this? Wasn't there a lecture about women in Islam in one of these lectures? Anyways, they're on YouTube for the benefit of those who are interested. The lectures which we usually record here in previous years are on YouTube, on my channel, One Way to Paradise, youtube.com/One Way to Paradise. And even if it's not in Malaysia, or Malaysia, I don't know how you're supposed to say it, but there are, I have at least 6 to 7 lectures on women in Islam and the rights of women in Islam and defending women in Islam, because the idea is that women are insignificant in Islam, women are inferior in Islam. There's a whole, you know, propaganda against it. But of course you may not watch the lecture as I'm speaking now, so I'll briefly answer you while referring you to the lecture, Who's Got It Like You? On YouTube, type Who's Got It Like You and then my name, or this guy over there, and then watch that lecture because it's detailed about the rights of women in Islam. But what is the role of women in Islam? Islam cannot exist and be efficient or beneficial to mankind without the existence of both genders. It's just nothing in this life can function without male and female. Do you understand? Without male and female, nothing can function. Enough said. But the reality is that some people, because of the hijab and because of, you know, certain restrictions, they believe that, you know, women in Islam are inferior. We say restrictions apply to both male and female. And these restrictions are meant to protect us and keep us pure. They're not there just for the heck of it. They're there for our own good, for our own benefit in the long run. In the case of women, because of their natural physical difference than men, they are, you know, materialized in her, covering herself a certain way, wherein it is not the case with men. Now you may argue, well, how come? Because some men may be handsome, blah, blah, blah. We can go on to this endless discussion about men should wear hijab as well, just like the women. Because, you know, some men are be like women, blah, blah, blah. But the reality is, from facts, from history, from even other religions, we see that there's that distinction between the male and the female. Anyways, Islam maintains the right of a woman as a daughter, as a mother, as a wife, as a sister. She's always the queen that someone has to take care of. Believe it or not, it's as simple as that. She's always the queen, she's the jewelry, she's the treasure that has to be taken care of. Now you may say, I don't need to be taken care of, I can take care of myself. Sure, but it is still the job of the Muslims in the world to maintain and protect the women. Why? Because reality is women are often attacked. How many men have been raped in the last year? How often do you hear about a man being raped when walking down the street? And how many women are raped? Come on, and these are not, forget about Islam and Muslims and religion. Take out religion. Let's just deal with facts. Who gets harassed, sexually harassed at work? How often does a woman, we know that nowadays women have become wild. But before, it was mainly male sexually harassing women, the boss with the secretary. Rarely is the other way around. So because of these facts, the way humans function, Islam came to give the woman special protection to keep these sick men away from her. Anyways, watch the lecture, Who's Got It Like You? It will hit the nail in the coffin shop. He's gonna unplug me.
Welcome once again, my friend. The first question is, some people don't really get exposure of Islam, like as well as I'm getting now. and some dies early, young. Talking about going to heaven and hell, I have other questions. This is the first question. This is the first question. Will they go to hell or heaven? Since they don't really get all the things. So the second question is, talking about the rest of the people. Let's say they are mature enough and normal enough and stuff. Let's say they do get exposure. There might be internal reasons for them, how you say they might be fanatic to some other religion or maybe pride or some other denial, whatever other reasons, they can't really accept Islam or something like that. Sometimes it's beyond their control, it's quite a debate whether they are in control or not of the whole thing that they are doing. Will they still be penalized for all these mistakes, mistakes at the end, And final question, the third one is, the drive, being scared of the hell and going to the paradise. It's more like paradise is more seen as it's very nice and something like that. In a way, it's kind of a desire. I feel that it's quite a desire I don't really would like to prefer that way of thinking of it as I want something I want to go to heaven and do all this, and I don't want to go to hell, and because of this I'm going to go through this. Okay. So when I'm not interested at the base itself, the basic level itself, not interested in something going after a good thing, how? That's a personal problem for me.
Understood, sir. Do we have an award for the best question? If we did, I would. We have one. What is it? A tissue? A book? We should give it to the gentleman. I praise all three questions. Very, very logical and expected. And I'm glad you gave me the opportunity to answer them. I just have to remember them now. What was the first one? That was a long question, man. Yes, there you go. I remember now. Just give me the key word, I'll remember the rest. So in regards to those who never get exposed, you said you were happy that you're getting a good exposure today. I was going to say you're getting exposed today, but that would have been nice. You're getting a good exposure to Islam. While others may not get that privilege. Actually, Islam has an answer for that as well. Because the Prophet Muhammad was asked a similar question, And he explained to the companions that besides the verses in the Quran that establish certain foundation, the foundation is you are only reliable if you know. If you don't know, then you are not reliable. So any human being who ever gets exposed to Islam in a proper way, then we say that he will be tested on the day of judgment in the life to come. No way he's going to go to hell for not knowing. You understand? And no way he's going to just jump into paradise without earning it. Which will answer the third question, because that I remember now, it was the last one. But the idea is, don't worry, because when we believe in God and His names and attributes, one of the most significant one that we humans can relate to, whether Muslims or non-Muslims, is the just. God is most just. When you have that belief, then you don't have to worry about the consequences of certain people who may have been, as we may think, in the wrong time or wrong location. Don't worry about it. They will be judged by God and they will be treated fairly. And the Prophet Muhammad told us that on the day of judgment, they will go through a test different than ours. Ours is now. Mine and yours is now, because we both heard the message of Islam and therefore we became liable for it. So those people are done. The key word for question two? You forgot too, huh?
It's pretty long. It's like more like I felt like the rest of them like actually get God exposed to the Islam.
Yes. I remember. You said that you're not sure whether they can control or they cannot control. They may have reasons.
Yeah.
No. The reality is, there's no way on earth that someone is forced to make their own choice. Meaning, when you are presented with the message of Islam, you say that someone may have reasons that prevent that person from being able to accept. And to that person, they may be valid, really valid reasons. I say, no matter what it is, that is never the case. Because it's a matter of faith. You may have physical conflicts with human beings, your own parents, your own society, your own religion, especially in Hinduism. It's very difficult for a Hindu to become a Muslim because he's automatically fought by the whole family, the whole society, his whole country. He may be burned to death. We know about the stories. In Christianity, sometimes it's the same issue, especially in Egypt. If a Coptic Christian were to become a Muslim, they get killed on the spot. So wait a second. So I'm saying there may be some physical hindrances in the way. But no one can control you internally. If you have seen this to be the salvation, then what excuse does one of us have to reject it? If your teacher told you that you have to do A, B, C in order to pass, right, and they're all doable, you can fail yourself. Before they throw me out of here, about that maybe the whole concept of heaven and hell doesn't motivate you, right? But in reality, everything else in this world of ours has a similar promise. And it seems to be motivating us pretty well. So, you know, you go to school because you promised a degree. And if you fail, then no degree. There you go. And everything you do, when you eat healthy, there's an expectation that you will maintain, you know, fitness and what have you. You will not become overweight. Everything has to do with the reward. We are reward oriented.
But doesn't it like make it like lack of food or something like that?
I understand what you're saying. No, because God created us like that. It's our innate nature to be desire-oriented. But because God gave us desires, He told us, in this life, contain them so that you can enjoy them later on. So it's just the way it is. Yes, it's a little materialistic and desire-oriented, but that's how you were created. You cannot go out of that fact. Human beings work like that.
Again, I remind all of our dear students here that please, if you have such discussions where you need to spend time with Brother Al-Muslim, he will be available for this week at the Islamic Society booth. So please take the effort to come down and do spend time with him, because that's the purpose why he came here. As for the questions, I have one last question with me, and I will go back to the female side for another last question from their side. Islam is the religion of peace, but I fail to understand why most Muslim countries have no peace. Example, they are fighting among themselves. What can you say about this?
What we can say about this is what we have been trying to tell the Muslims for the longest time. Muslims amongst Muslims, why do we have lectures? Why do we have seminars? Why do we have these topics discussed? To call people back to Islam. Because we all know, Muslims and non-Muslims, all know that in terms of practicing the religion properly, as practiced by the companions of the Prophet, peace be upon him, the minority of Muslims are at that level. The majority are somewhere else. Because of our abandonment of the religious teachings, we are fighting internally, we have no peace in our countries, and the whole nine yards. Besides the influence from different powers, which we don't have to, you know, delve into, I'm sure we all understand each other. But we realize that there's an internal conflict within the country, and there are many interests from around the world in these particular countries for different resources. So you have to realize that, yes, it's easy to have the Muslims fight, but then who started the fight? Anyways, we wouldn't have fought had we been all following our religion properly. So the answer to this question is, yes, you're right. If Muslims were to follow Islam properly, then a lot of these, they cannot eliminate them, but a lot of these fights would be terminated. So the end result is, we as Muslims do not practice our religion properly. But then again, that's exactly why we have these lectures, so we can remind ourselves to practice our religion properly.
Is that clear? Okay. The final questions from the US side.
I have two questions. I can hope to restrict them, keep them short. So first of all, like, I would like to thank you on behalf of everyone here for flying all the way here and giving us a speech. And now I'll get to my question. Sure. So my first question will be, when people ask me, like, how is Islam so different from other religions? Like, Islam and Christianity, if you compare them together, they are similar in some ways. So I will tell them what you just explained for the lecture, so I won't bring it up. But how is Islam different from other religions?
Okay.
That's the first question. And my second question will be, well, it's not really a question, it's a concern to, I don't know what's your name, but you, it's just saying that we came to a Muslim talk, and yes, there are things that he said might be very narrow-minded. Not narrow-minded. So sorry for the word.
It's okay. I'm immune.
But just let them speak over. Quoting the prophet, our prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "To my religion, be my religion. To your religion, be your religion." And Islam has no intention of putting another religion down. So if you say that this is crazy and the talk is whatever you say, that's your opinion. I'm just saying from my opinion and my point of view, Islam doesn't put another religion down. Islam is beautiful in its own ways, and Christianity is beautiful in its own ways. So let's not get emotional. Like, I understand your point of view, at the same time I understand his point of view. So let's all come to an understanding here, and that's all. But my first question though, I'm curious about that. Thank you.
Right. Well, allow me to comment on the second thing first, because, you know, we're trying to put the fire out, and we don't want to ignite anything. I believe that that person who was asking the question, we came to some sort of mutual understanding that this is to be continued, and so it is to be continued. And again, it's not about, look, anytime you praise something, you're indirectly dispraising its opponent. It's just life. Basketball, the NBA champions, when you highlight what they have done, it's on the expense of defeating the other team, who might be good as well. But in the process of trying to highlight something, you have to make a comparison wherein the other party will be taken some criticism. All we're trying to communicate is we want to be mature enough to deal with this criticism and either prove it to be valid or invalid without anyone taking anything personal. I think we reached that point. Personally, I think we're at the same level, so no issue. There's no issue regarding that. There's different views on things. So we will deal with it tomorrow, inshallah, in the one-on-one session amongst many other people. The first question is, what differentiates Islam from Christianity or any other religion? Besides what we mentioned in the lecture, I mean, it's simple. We say Islam is the only, again, the only one that gives you a comprehensive, complete way of life. Meaning, we love Jesus. Muslims love Jesus, we claim, more than anyone else in the world, right? Because he's a prophet of God, he's in our Quran mentioned 25 times, his mother has a chapter named after her, and I can go on about Jesus until next year. But at the end of the day, no matter how much we love Jesus, or no matter how much a Christian loves Jesus, if that person wanted to live like Jesus, as per the available information in the scripture or from history, little is known as to how things were done. How can you be an example to emulate Jesus or Mary? And so we say there's a prophet of God who's an example to be followed, but his heritage over the years has not been really maintained. It's the God's decree, it was not maintained. In fact, there's conflict about so many things about it, crucifixion and so on and so forth, and we're not going to go into that. But when we come to Islam, if a Muslim wants to know what to say when he wakes up, we have teachings from the Prophet. If he wants to know when you go to the bathroom, how to relieve yourself, and which hands to use, and what remembrance of God to say before you enter, and after you leave, and then when you want to eat, which hand to eat with, what to say before you eat, after you eat, how to pray in detail, how to fast in detail, how to perform pilgrimage in detail, how the Prophet looked, how he behaved, how he dealt with his wives, how he dealt with the people. Every single thing that you may need in this life and you want an example to follow, we find that the Quran, Islam, gives you an ultimate solution to all of that. So it is the most comprehensive way of life. While other ways of life do exist, but they're not comprehensive enough for you to say, I'm truly following a messenger of God. But, and the interesting thing is, it's the only one that will tell you, no, you also have to believe in these messengers of God. Yes, you don't have the heritage of Jesus, but you have to believe in Jesus. And you don't have the heritage of Moses, but you have to believe in Moses. That will not be found among other religions. The Jews don't believe in Jesus, right? Otherwise, they wouldn't be Jews, they would be Christians. They rejected him. They said he's an imposter, he's a liar, they tried to crucify him. The Christians don't believe in Muhammad, otherwise they would have been Muslims. So we find that if the Jews to Christians, Christians to Muslims, there's a gap. But Muslims, if you believe in Jesus, yes, believe in Moses, yes, so we believe in the prophets of these religions, even their scriptures, the Torah and the Gospel. We believe in them, but we believe that they're not maintained in their revelation as revealed, and therefore they're no longer reliable to know who God is. The Quran is the final revelation that highlights all of these issues. So from a very logical point of view, we have certain elements that are unique in the sense that it gives you a direction in life that you may not be able to find in other faiths, with all due respect.
Jazakallah khair, brother Musab.